Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord, to St. Philip Lutheran Church here in Raleigh, North Carolina, for our service of worship and praise this Sunday morning. Obviously, this is Easter Sunday when we celebrate the fact that Jesus Christ has been resurrected from the grave, from the tomb of death. He has conquered sin, death, and the devil once for all time, for all people everywhere. We are so glad to be counted in that number. He has won for us the forgiveness of our sins, free salvation, and eternal life. We are absolutely delighted that you have chosen to worship with us this morning, either here in person or virtually online. We are blessed by your presence and your participation in this worship service. Finally, we thank you for your continued financial support of our mission and ministry here at St. Philip. Put quite simply, we could not do it without you. We never take that for granted. We appreciate you more than you know. You may continue to give here in person, obviously, through the mail or via our church website, which is stphilip.org. That's st-philip.org. At this time, we are actually going to have our children's message. We are moving it up to the front portion of our worship service just for today, and you will soon see why. So we call on Kai Thoreau now for our children's message.
And any children can come forward and join me on the floor. No, we're doing this at a different time. You weren't ready to come up yet. That's okay. All right, good morning. So today is a special day. Does anybody know what day it is?
Easter.
It's Easter! That's right! And on Easter, we celebrate that God raised Jesus from the dead, and the tomb that Jesus was put in is empty. So Jesus is alive, and that's great news. And it makes us really, really happy. And so I have a question. When you're happy, how do you show that you're happy?
Showing
smiling. Ooh, smiling faces. Yeah, that's a great way to show that you're happy. Ooh, yep. What about, Nico, were you doing some clapping? Is that how you show you're happy, is from clapping? Yeah, that's great. Any other ways that you say, show that you're happy? Oh, do you sing? Ooh, singing, that's a great way to show that we're happy. We do a lot of singing in church. Ooh, raising your eyebrows, yeah. You can do that to show that you're happy, absolutely. Yeah, I'm real happy. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm happy, I say some fun words to show and to let people know that I'm happy. Like, have you ever said, yippee?
Yippee.
Oh, yippee, yeah, there it is. Or have you ever said, yay?
Yay!
Yay! Yeah, or maybe even, woohoo!
Woohoo!
Yeah! Those are all great ways to show and let people know that we're happy. And in the church, a lot of times, we have one really fancy word that we use to show that we are extremely happy. And we're going to use that word a whole lot today. Because we are super happy that Jesus is raised from the dead and is alive. And that's really exciting. So we're super happy about it. So we're going to use this word a lot today. And that word is the word alleluia. Can you say that with me?
Alleluia.
Yeah, and we're going to invite the congregation to say it too. You ready? Alleluia. Oh, that's perfect. That was great. And so today, I have a little something for each of you. I have some these little tiny banners here. These say the word alleluia on it. And I have a challenge for you, and in a little bit, I'm going to actually have you help me pass these out to a whole bunch of people in the congregation, and every time today that you hear the word alleluia, you're going to raise your little flag, your little alleluia banner, and go, yay! Just like that. And so if you end up with one of these in the congregation, your challenge as well is to raise your little banner and go, yay! After an alleluia. So we're going to come up, you guys can come up here and grab one. You can take, there's a bunch of different colors.
Oh, I love purple.
You love purple? Yeah, grab that purple one. You want a blue one?
She wants a pink one.
A pink one? You want the red one? All right. Yeah, sounds good. Do you have a favorite color?
Yellow?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a lot of these extra banners here. I'm going to take one too, but we're going to practice real quick. You ready? So if I were to say the word, Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Yay. Yep, you raise it up like this, and you wave it back and forth. Yeah, just like that. So you ready? Alleluia. Yay. Yep, and you can say yay, or you can say Alleluia. That's perfect. So we're going to practice. I'm going to say it three more times, and we're going to see if you can pay attention and do it. You ready? Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Yay.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Yeah, you guys got this. You don't even need me to do the third one. So, congregation, if you get a banner, you got to be just as good as these kids up here with the alleluias. Yay!
Yay! Oh, you got it.
You got to pay attention. All right. So, our good news today is that Jesus is alive and with us all the time. And the good news is that God's love is with us all the time, just like Jesus is, no matter what happens. And that's our good news today. And for that, we say, Alleluia! All right, so I'm going to invite you to repeat after me in prayer and invite the congregation to join as well.
Dear God,
thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
And for raising him from the dead.
And for raising him from the dead.
It makes us so happy.
It makes us so happy.
That we celebrate this morning.
That we celebrate this morning.
By saying, Alleluia!
Alleluia!
We love you.
We love you.
Amen. All right. If you guys want to help pass these out, if anybody in the congregation wants one, you can raise your hand and some of the kids will bring them to you. Or I will. Somebody will. We'll make sure you get one. All right. Thanks for coming up. You guys can head back to your seats. Do you want to take some to give out to people? Oh, thank you. Do you want to give some to people? There you go. All right. Let's go give them to people out there. Anybody else want one? Raise your hands for us. Oh, yeah. We got some over here. Cool. Yeah, awesome.
Yeah. Thank you. I'll see you in a bit.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Yay. Please rise as you are able for the renewal of baptismal promises. In the waters of baptism, we have passed over from death to life with Jesus Christ, and we are a new creation. For this saving mystery, for this water in our baptismal font, let us bless God, who was, who is, and who is to come. We thank you, God, for your river of life flowing freely from your throne, through the earth, through the city, through every living thing. You rescued Noah and his family from the flood. You opened wide the sea for the Israelites. Now in these waters you flood us with mercy, and our sin is drowned forever. You open the gate of righteousness, and we pass safely through. In Jesus Christ, you calm and trouble the waters. You nourish us and enclose us in safety. You call us forth and send us out. In lush and barren places, you are with us. You have become our salvation. Now breathe upon this water and awaken your church once more. Claim us again as your beloved and holy people. Quench our thirst, cleanse our hearts, wipe away every tear. To you, our beginning and our end, our shepherd and lamb, be honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Let us then renew the promises once made in holy baptism, in which we once renounced the devil and all his works and all his ways, set forth our faith in God the Father, in Jesus Christ, God's Son, and in the Holy Spirit, and promised faithful service to God in his holy church. I therefore ask you, do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways?
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth?
I believe.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, who descended into hell, and on the third day rose again from the dead, who ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from whence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead?
I believe.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting?
I believe.
Do you promise to abide in this faith and in the covenant of your baptism, and as a member of the church, to be diligent in the use of the means of grace and in prayer?
I do,
by the help of God. Let us pray. May the Almighty and everlasting God, who has vouchsafed to regenerate us by water and the Spirit, and has forgiven us all our sins, strengthen and preserve us by His grace unto eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our gathering hymn this Easter Sunday morning is Jesus Christ is Risen Today. Is risen.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Why do you look for the living among the dead?
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Remember how He spoke to you.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Son of Man must be crucified and on the third day rise again.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia. My arm is tired, Kai.
Alleluia.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia. Alleluia. You may be seated at this time for the reading of God's holy word.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 10, as follows. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That announced how God anointed, you know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read responsively Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's mercy endures forever.
Let Israel now declare, God's mercy endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation.
Shouts of rejoicing.
The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly.
I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord indeed punished me sorely, but did not hand me over to death. This is the gate of the Lord. Here the righteous may enter.
I give thanks to you, for you have answered me, and you have become my salvation.
The stone that builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
By the Lord has this been done. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from the book of Colossians chapter 3 as follows. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 28th chapter, beginning with the first verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you this day for resurrecting your Son, Jesus Christ, from the grave and conquering death. We could not thank you enough for all of your blessings to us. May we hear and see and sense and feel and appreciate the good news of resurrection this day in a way different than ever before. May today mark a new beginning in each one of our lives. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My sermon text for this Easter Sunday morning is the gospel account of Jesus' resurrection, found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. My sermon title for today is, "He was standing there." He was standing there. Do you remember Can you recall the very first time you realized that the world wasn't necessarily a good and safe place? Can you recall your earliest memory of evil or destruction? Mine occurred when I was probably around the age of 3 or 4 or so, I'm guessing. I was blessed to have a stable family, a stable home environment, and so I was exposed mostly to love and positivity, from what I can recall. But around the age of 3 or 4, I can recall carving a pumpkin into a jack-o'-lantern for Halloween and leaving it on the front porch of our apartment in Greensboro. And I can remember coming home late one evening with my parents and discovering that the pumpkin had been smashed on the street just down the little hill from our apartment's front door. I have always recalled that incident vividly in my mind because I could not understand it, and it scared me. Of course, having grown up years later, I was aware that it was inevitably the result of a prank at the hands of some mischievous teenagers, no doubt, who probably didn't mean any real harm, but were just out to have some fun. But when I think back to my childhood, to the years of innocence, to my primordial, still developing baby-like mind, I realize how traumatized I was. It had not yet occurred to me that someone could simply take what did not belong to them. I had not yet been introduced to the fact that someone could simply destroy on a whim what you had built. It never dawned on me that complete strangers could walk up the front steps to your home and do something to hurt or harm you or your family. I remember thinking for the first time, there's another world out there. It's a world that mama and daddy cannot necessarily protect me from. It's a world of danger, destruction, and evil, where random people can take your random pumpkin and randomly smash it in the street. Now, I don't know if you can identify a particular memory in your life from your own infancy or youth, but I think everyone in here knows what I'm talking about. And in the overall scheme of things, having your jack-o'-lantern smashed in a youthful, mischievous prank isn't a huge deal at all compared to what many experience. But isn't it a traumatic moment when you first realize that this world isn't necessarily a good and safe place? When you first realize that mama and daddy and grandma and grandpa can't protect you at all times and in all places? When you realize that other people are capable of and willing to hurt you? When you become aware for the first time that there's stuff out there lurking in the shadows which not only does not have your best interests at heart, but which will also gladly abuse you or take advantage of you if given the chance. As silly as it sounds, I was horrified by that smashed pumpkin. I was mortified, aghast, scared, traumatized by my introduction to the world beyond my protective and loving family. That pumpkin wasn't the only thing that got smashed that night. At the tender age of around 3, I was first introduced to the notion, the concept, the reality of fear. All of us have such moments. The tragic thing about it is we learn to adapt as we grow. We learn that to be weak and vulnerable means we risk all sorts of things, and so we become hard and mean.
We learn that to be nice and kind means we invite abuse. And so we become aloof and standoffish. We learn that to help somebody out risks being taken advantage of, and so we become cold and look the other way when others suffer. We learn to navigate in and negotiate our way around a world of fear. And the next thing you know, we're smashing others' pumpkins, engaging in precisely the same sort of unhealthy and destructive patterns of behavior that were originally visited upon us in the name of survival, self-preservation, doing stuff to others before they do it to us. We learn early to join in the picking on and teasing and taunting of other kids, because that decreases the chances that the crowd will turn on us and do that to us. So we grow into adults who continue similar patterns of behavior, all because we're afraid of this wicked world we inhabit, and we don't know how else to be or what else to do in such a dog-eat-dog, broken-down world. Over and against all of that stands one historical reality, one world-transforming and life-altering occurrence, one moment of direct God intervention, which just happens to be the subject of our gospel text this morning and serves as the purpose for our gathering in here, not only today, but also every Sunday. 2,000 years ago, something happened, which not only inaugurated a new world, a new life, a new way of being, which contrasted to our world of smashing pumpkins, but also conquered, defeated, and vanquished that world. The Son of God, the incarnate Word of God made flesh, was resurrected from the grave of death on the third day after He had been executed. There is a double new beginning of sorts there in verse 1. The first day of the week was dawning. It was a new day of a new week. Verse 2 indicates the sudden and abrupt interruption of the supernatural. Suddenly there was a great earthquake. The earth itself moved and trembled and shook. An angel of the Lord descended from heaven, rolled back the stone, and sat on it. Verse 3 informs us that His appearance was like lightning and His clothing white as snow. The guards, the sentries of the tomb, react with shaking, just like the earth, according to verse 4, and indeed themselves becoming like the dead man that they were guarding. None of this is subtle, my friends. None of this involves nuance. The first four words out of the angel's mouth in verse number 5 are verbatim the exact same first four words out of Jesus' mouth in verse number 10. Do not be afraid. Let's see. An earthquake, an angel descending from heaven, a massive stone rolled away, countenance of lightning, garments of brilliance, and do not be afraid. A world of smashed pumpkins and hopes and dreams and aspiration and innocence, and do not be afraid. A world of oppression and persecution, of trial and tribulation, racism, sexism, ageism, of murder and rape and environmental degradation, a world of warfare and violence, genocide and ethnic cleansing, of cancer, malaria, heart disease, Parkinson's and Alzheimer's, of loneliness, despair, depression, despondency, of injustice, unemployment and human trafficking, and do not be afraid? No offense, but it's going to take more than words, more than just saying it. In a world of fear, you can't just wish it away. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. The angel continues in verse 5. He is not here, for He has been raised, as He said. Come, see the place where He lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, He has been raised from the dead. And indeed, He is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see Him. This is my message for you. So they left the tomb quickly with what? fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Fear is not yet dispelled. Fear is not yet cast out. It's still present, though now intermingled with great joy and excitement. Maybe, just maybe, perhaps, could it be true? We as human beings are equally paralyzed by a fear of evil, destruction, and wickedness as we are by one which dares to state, dares to claim that all of that stuff doesn't have the final word and will no longer exist in this new life and world and kingdom. We are as afraid of the disparaging reality of our lives so far as we are to hope in a radically new and different future. We are, in many ways, bound up by fear. Suddenly, verse 9 says, Jesus met them. Wait, I don't get it. The angel just said, he is going ahead of me to Galilee. There I will see him. Galilee is some 80 to 90 miles north of here in Jerusalem, where the text is set. And it'll take me a good few days to travel there by foot in this pre-automobile age. So, in my hopeful fear, at best, I was expecting to maybe see Jesus in a few days and in another place. But verse 9 says, suddenly, Jesus met them. I was expecting to see Jesus maybe later on, maybe after death up in heaven one day. But verse 9 says, suddenly, Jesus met them. The Revised English Bible says here, Jesus was in their path. The New American reads, Jesus met them on their way. And the New Jerusalem renders it, and suddenly coming to meet them was Jesus. As much as you want to meet Him, my friends, He wants to meet you even more. As much as you may be journeying towards Him, He is journeying towards you even more. As much as you may seek grace, mercy, forgiveness, acceptance, hope, and restoration, grace, mercy, forgiveness, acceptance, hope, and restoration seek you even more. As much as you want not to believe, not to hope, not to hold out faith in something more, something different, something better, something more, something different, and something better is in your path. Meets you on your way. Is coming to meet you. Suddenly, Jesus met them. The venerable poet Maya Angelou once said, "People will not remember what you said. They will not remember what you did. But they will never forget how you made them feel." People will not remember what you said. They will not remember what you did. But they will never, ever forget how you made them feel. Several years ago, our nation celebrated that legendary pioneering baseball player Jackie Robinson's breaking of the color barrier in professional baseball some 70 plus years ago now. Another immortal player, Henry Hank Aaron, who 40-some years ago broke the home run record, was offered the opportunity to give his reflections on Robinson on that milestone anniversary. So Aaron began by talking about how his father used to always sternly squash his boyhood dream of growing up to play Major League Baseball, understandably out of his own justifiable fear and pain, by telling a young Henry, "Forget it. They ain't gonna let no black folk play baseball." And then Hank Aaron reminisced about actually skipping school one day to go and meet this Jackie Robinson, who happened to be in town that day. And I quote, "He came with the Brooklyn Dodgers to Mobile, Alabama, for an exhibition game in 1948. I went to hear him talk to a crowd in front of a drugstore. I don't remember what he said. It didn't matter what he said. He was standing there. And after that day, my father never told me again that I couldn't be a ball player. I was allowed to dream after that. People will not remember what you said. They will not remember what you did, but they will never forget how you made them feel. I don't remember what he said. It didn't matter what he said. He was standing there. He was standing there. And I was allowed to dream again after that. In verse number 9, after Jesus meets the two Marys on their way, he says simply, greetings. The word in the original Greek text is kairete, which is translated several ways, some saying hail, H-A-I-L. Other translations, rejoice, be glad, good morning, or peace be with you. But I must confess, in this rare instance, I don't care what he said. For all I care, he could have said green eggs and ham. I don't like them, Sam, I am. When I get older and my mental faculties start to diminish, I'm not going to remember what he said. I'm not going to remember what he did, but I will never forget how he made me feel. I may not remember all 10 commandments, all 8 beatitudes, or even the 23rd Psalm, as beautiful and sublime as it is. If my mind gets cloudy enough, I may not be able to remember the Apostles' Creed or the Lord's Prayer, but I will never forget how Jesus made me feel. I may not remember all 66 books of the Bible, the 3 great creeds, or the 7 great ecumenical councils. I may not remember exactly how many crowds he fed, with how many fish and how many loaves of bread, and how much was taken over after each time. I may not remember exactly how many times he walked on water or calmed the stormy seas, or exactly which Mary it was who anointed him in this gospel or in that gospel. Lazarus, the daughter of Jairus, and the widow's son from Nain, all of whom he raised, may all fade into the fog of debilitated mental capacity, but I will never forget how he made me feel, how he met me on my way, how he came to me along my path, how he made me feel like I was somebody when others made me feel insignificant, how he made me feel like I was of value when I discounted my own self-worth. When he met me on my way, I don't remember what he said. It didn't matter what he said. He was standing there. He was crucified, but then he was standing there. They killed him and they buried him, but 3 days later, he was, guess what? Standing there. He suffered for our sake, but now, he is standing here. And because he's standing here, you and I can dream again. Because he's standing here, all things are possible. Because he's standing here, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. You and I are more than conquerors. He who is within us is greater than him who is in this world. Because he's standing here, if God be for us, who can be against us? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? And because of that, I am allowed to dream again. Oh, my smashed pumpkin has been put back together. My life has been put back together again. Fear has been cast out. Life trumps death. Hope trumps despair. Joy trumps sorrow. And love trumps everything. Oh, he might have said hail to us when he met us on our way, but I think it would behoove us to sing it back to him now. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him, what? Lord of all. O seed of Israel's chosen race, now ransomed from the fall, hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him, Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball to him all majesty ascribe and crown him, and crown him, and crown him. Do you remember? Can you recall the very first time you realized that the world was redeemed? He was standing there. Amen. We ask that you please rise now as you are able. So we join together in singing our hymn of the day, Thine is the Glory.
Living together in trust and hope, we profess our faith.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. You call your church to witness to your salvation. We give thanks for all theologians, preachers, and teachers who proclaim your gospel. Equip all the baptized to share the joy of the resurrection in all we say and do. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You bring abundant life throughout creation. The green blade rises, and all creation greets the resurrection dawn. Preserve vineyards and orchards and those who tend to them. Feed us with the fruits of creation. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You show your steadfast love without regard to borders, barriers, or human-made divisions. Infuse your justice in every nation of the world, that all experience the peace that only you can give. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You anointed your Son with the Holy Spirit and with power. Encourage us by his example in our ministries of healing, care, and outreach. We pray for all who are sick or hospitalized, and for all healthcare workers who care for them. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have put gladness in our hearts. Inspire musicians and dancers to rejoice with songs of victory. Bless the music ministries of this congregation and all who foster our assembly's song. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As you have raised Jesus from the dead, you show us your resurrection promise. With your holy ones who have sung your praise, free us from fear and empower us to go and tell the good news. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift to you now, O Lord, the names of those for whom we have special concern, praying for healing, wisdom, and peace. Sally, Natalie. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen. As the family of St. Philip, we ask that you open our ears to hear your call for us and guide our feet in following. Help us to be good stewards of our time and treasure and to put our trust in you to provide. We ask for blessings on the life of our pastor and that your Spirit guide us in relationship and ministry. We put our hope in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another now, as well as with those online via the back cameras and more personally up at the front monitor. God's peace be with you. Jesus teaches us in his most famous sermon of all, the Sermon on the Mount, not to lay up for ourselves treasures here on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. Rather, he says, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consume and thieves do not and cannot, obviously, break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. If you have not already given online, we invite you to join with me now in making presentation of all of our tithes and offerings unto the Lord via the offering plates in the back. We thank you very much. Please rise as we join in our offertory. This is the feast of victory for our God. Let us pray. Generous God, in this meal you offer your very self. We give thanks for these gifts of the earth. In the breaking of this bread, reveal to us the risen one. In the pouring of this wine, pour us out in service to the world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. We celebrate together now the Lord's Supper, the feast of Holy Communion. And now may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Scripture tells us that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we now pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Come and know Christ, broken and poured out for you. You may be seated for the distribution. All are invited to the Lord's table. All are welcome at the Lord's table. Small children are invited forward for a blessing. Please simply follow the directions printed in your bulletin and of the ushers. Please rise to receive our post-communal blessing. And now may the eating of Christ's body and the drinking of his blood strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, generous God, for in this bread and cup we have tasted the new heaven and earth where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives, in Jesus' name, amen.
Partners in ministry, what is our calling?
Jesus asks that we love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. Jesus tells us that a second is like it. We shall love our neighbors as ourselves. We answer that call, and we go out to share the love of Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated for a few brief announcements and mission opportunities. First off, my younger son is here, Tristan, who is age 5, with his mom, Zudi. I don't see them. Are they in the kids' corner? Is he playing? Okay. So for those of you who did not meet him last week, I wanted you to know that he is here, that they are here. If you'd like to meet them on their way out, I'm sure they would appreciate that, and I would appreciate that. The second thing is that the church office is closed tomorrow. So Jesus may have left his tomb, but Kai and I and Jane are going into our tomb for a day of restoration and rest. On Wednesday, Pastor's Bible study on the book of Acts resumes. It will be held at both 10:30 a.m. and 6:45 p.m. in the music room down the hall. We will also do our best to provide a Zoom link for that as well, which can be found on our church website. Saturday, April the 22nd, from 10 a.m. till noon, we have a new members class. So if you know you'd like to join St. Philip, or you're not sure you want to join us, but you are more interested in our church and about our ministries, we invite you to that as well. You need not join. Again, that's Saturday, April the 22nd, from 10 a.m. till noon. You can register by calling the church office and leaving a message for our church secretary, Jane Gu. On Saturday, April the 29th, from 5 to 7 p.m., we are celebrating our 60th anniversary as a church. We will have a founder's dinner that night, honoring all those who founded this church within its first decade of existence. Please RSVP to that soon. Seating is limited. Registration is online on our website, or you can fill out a form in the Narthex as soon as you leave the sanctuary or in Kipley Hall down here. But we are promised a great meal, dynamic speakers, laughter, nostalgia, and entertainment. I don't know if I'm on that list or not, but maybe I will be. Also, Ed Helmy was born on Easter Sunday 95 years ago. Ed, please stand. Hallelujah. And finally, I had a text message from a good friend of mine in Philadelphia asking about or commenting on our Good Friday worship service here, saying how much he enjoyed the music. And I just thought that was fantastic, so I thanked him. But then on top of that, he called later and said, "Who is that musician? Is that your regular musician, or is that some special ringer you guys brought in?" Hallelujah. And that's the truth. That's not blowing smoke. So we have a gem in you, Reagan. Thank you so very much for sharing your gifts here with us. Are there any further announcements at this time? I see Claire's hand up. If we could get her a mic.
Just a reminder, we're having ladies' lunch on Thursday at the Olive Garden. Just let me know if you would like to come.
Amen. Anybody else? If not, please rise to receive the benediction of our Lord. And now may the God of all, who raised Jesus from the dead, bless you by the power of the Holy Spirit to live in the new creation. Amen. Our sending hymn this afternoon is "The Day of Resurrection." Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Go in peace. Serve the risen one. Thanks be to God.